Krishna to chair the first session, which is on cognition and consciousness across species. I also invite the other speakers of that session to take their chair at this place. So that would be Tetsuro Matsusawa, Soumya Iyengar, and Binoy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sangeeta. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the first session of this conference, which is on cognition and consciousness across species. Let me just say a few words to set the stage for this session. Empirical and observational studies on the cognitive abilities of non-human species and their underlying mechanisms develop primarily because we assume that their intelligence and, if one may use the term mind, are most like our own. Through our understanding of them, we would therefore one day possibly understand what it is to be essentially human. However, this view that non-human and human species represent a continuum in mental abilities coexists in our minds rather uneasily, I think, with the equally pervasive idea that non-human species differ fundamentally from us because they lack sophisticated language and may thus lack some of the capacities necessary for reasoning and abstract thought. Comparative studies on different taxa along the primate lineage, for example, nevertheless may throw light on the nature and evolution of different human cognitive abilities, including that very elusive phenomenon, consciousness. One particular functional perspective provides a categorization of consciousness into perceptual consciousness, the state or faculty of being mentally conscious or aware of anything, and reflective consciousness, the recognition by the thinking subject of its own actions and mental states. Thus, if an animal was perceptually conscious, it would be able to believe, think, or remember. But if in addition, if it was reflectively conscious, it would be aware of its beliefs, thoughts, or memories. Current thinking holds that some mammalian species, including higher primates, dolphins, or elephants, may be perceptually conscious, but are unlikely to be reflectively so. But what I want to stress here is that the principal reason for this bias against the belief that these species can reflect on their thoughts and actions is methodological. People can tell us what they are aware of, animals cannot. These perspectives that I'm talking about, of course, depend on several theoretical frameworks to investigate cognition in animals in terms of mentalistic notions. One such framework for perceptual consciousness is that of the intentional stance, which assumes that each individual is an intentional system capable of mental states. Another important functional framework that encompasses attribution, in other words, it tries to understand whether an individual is capable of attributing thoughts, emotions, and desires to another individual, is what has been argued to have a theory of mind. Social animals in particular appear to be knowledgeable about one another's behavior to different extents, but do they know as much about each other's beliefs and intentions? Are they adept at recognizing the similarities and differences between their own and other states of mind? Behavioral decision-making processes need to be analyzed very carefully in these non-verbalizing species in order to ascertain whether higher order intentionality can indeed be invoked as underlying mechanisms governing behavioral acts. More complex manifestations of the ability to attribute mental states and perspectives to others would also seem to require that individuals be reflectively conscious and possess some degree of self-awareness. For individuals to clearly distinguish between their own thoughts and beliefs and those of others, for example, would obviously require some accessibility to their own minds. Current evidence for self-awareness in animals seems to be patchy and inconsistent. Self-recognition refers to the ability of an animal to distinguish oneself from others without implying any awareness in doing so. Self-consciousness, in contrast, is a kind of meta-self-awareness which implies that an individual is aware of its own state of mind and can use this awareness to predict and explain the behavior of both oneself and of others. This distinction becomes important because very few mental processes ever become accessible to consciousness. Hence, it is entirely possible that animals may be able to recognize its own position in a social group distinguish between its own motives and those of others, and even attribute some beliefs to others without having reflective access to their own minds. In other words, they could be blind, they could have blind sight. Higher order intentionality can be effective, however, only in the presence of some degree of truly reflective consciousness. To successfully deceive an audience, for example, an individual must be able to attribute false beliefs to others, and this can be achieved only if an animal is capable of comparing its own knowledge with that of other individuals. Such a task clearly demands at least some level of self-consciousness, including an ability to be introspective. We hope to explore during this meeting, and particularly this session, some of these theoretical and philosophical issues in animal cognitive psychology, ranging from mental representation to distributed cognition, from simple, possibly learned behavioral responses to more complex, self-based decision-making mechanisms, ultimately leading to the current status of our understanding of higher cognitive processes and consciousness in non-human species vis-a-vis ourselves, humans. So let me begin the session by inviting Professor Tetsuro Matsuzawa from the Primate Research Institute of the University of Kyoto in Inuyama in Japan to deliver the first talk. Professor Matsuzawa.
Good morning. It's my great pleasure to be here to talk about my study on chimpanzees. Please focus on the slides. Outline of talk today, I will give you the introduction first that illustrates my research in the field and in the laboratory. And that is followed by four major topics: imitation, language, social bond, and imagination. So, introduction. The key question is, what is uniquely human? This is Japanese monkeys. Well, I really prefer the dark room. So could you turn off the light, please? Because for the video presentation, I really need the dark room. Thank you very much. Not many people recognize there are no monkeys and apes in North America and in Europe. No American monkeys, no British monkeys, no French monkeys, no German monkeys. So look at the map. Green area occupied by non-human primates in Central South America, Africa, India, and Southeast Asia, including Japan. This means there are no monkeys and apes in North America and in Europe. So Japan is very rare country that has indigenous native monkey in the summit country or G7 country. So what is uniquely human? The key question, why I'm focusing on chimpanzees? That is the idea of outgroup, paying attention to the outside. That may bring you the insight about in-group. So for humans, what is out-group? That is chimpanzees, gorillas, and orangutans. Orangutan? Gorilla. Orangutan. Gorilla. Orangutan, gorilla, orangutan, gorilla. Orangutan lives in Borneo and Sumatra, Malaysia and Indonesia in Asia, gorilla in Africa, chimpanzees in Africa, bonobos, the same genus, different species of chimpanzees in Africa. The relationship between chimpanzees and bonobos is Homo sapiens and Homo neanderthalensis. As you know, Neanderthal man lived in up to 30,000 years ago in Europe. So Homo one genus to a species at that time, but gone, only Homo sapiens. But Pantroglodytes, Pan paniscus, chimpanzees, bonobos, at present. And they are from Africa, and we are from Africa. So take home messages first. Human is a primate. Human is a primate species. So say non-human primates for monkeys and apes. They are non-human primates. We are human primate. Don't say human and primates. Primates include humans, okay? That is very important point. Then chimpanzee is not a monkey. Chimpanzee is a hominid. Chimpanzee is called ape, you may call ape, but not monkeys. And chimpanzee is a family of hominid. Look at the bottom of gorilla. This is gorilla. No tails. Chimpanzees, bonobos, no tails. Orangutan, no tails. We humans, no tails. Right? So we are the same family. We are not monkeys. We are hominid that has no tail and big. So people used to do the study of chimpanzees in the laboratory and also in the world, and use careful observation in the field, and you do the precise experiments in the laboratory, that's fine. But if you make the 2x2 contingency table, there are two missing windows. You may do the experiments in the field, what I named field experiments. You may do a careful observation in the laboratory, what I name it participant observation. I will give you the explanation. So laboratory experiment called I Project started in 1978, April 14th. So I chimpanzee, now 39 years old, from 1 year old on, so 38 years, I have been studying these chimpanzees. The first paper published in Nature 30 years ago. So that is done in the Primate Research Institute of Kyoto University. We have a group of 13 chimpanzees of 3 generations in a group. That outdoor compound is connected to the 2 huge cages, green one and silver one. I want to show what's going on at the moment. So from chimpanzee viewpoint, 1, 2, 3, 4 entrance to the cognitive test booth. So 24 hours a day, whenever you want, you may come into the booth to do the test. So this is a brand new facility. So everything is predetermined, controlled by the computer. So the experimenter makes the cognitive test, 1, 4, 2, 7, 9, touching the numerals in an ascending order, and the correct response is rewarded by a tiny, tiny 8mm cube of apple. So this is really the size of Antiaris africana, their favorite fruit in the wild. And anytime you may leave. Then the next chimpanzee come to the booth. So based on their free will, they come to participate the booth test. And to recognize who's there, we use a video camcorder to do the fully automated face recognition system. So we know which chimpanzee is doing this task. As you can see, Every chimpanzee has a different stage of learning and different test. So we do the particular test for a particular chimpanzee. So that is very traditional and advanced stage of laboratory testing with computer system. What I say, participant observation in the laboratory is very careful observation of their life. It's not me, Matsuzawa, who started the comparison of humans and chimpanzees. Almost 100 years, the psychologists in the West, they did the comparing, they did compare the chimpanzees and humans. And their way is just like this. Put a baby chimpanzee at home. You keep the two species in exactly the same condition. You talk to the babies. Suppose that only human baby starts speaking, but not chimpanzee. And the conclusion says, oh, language is uniquely human. I was forced to adopt the abandoned baby chimpanzee at home 30 years ago. And I immediately recognized it's not fair to compare the two species like this, because my daughter has the parents, but the chimpanzee baby has no parents at all. You take the baby out from the biological mother and put into human environment. Is it fair? It's not fair, not scientific, not ethical anymore. They are hominid. If you take a baby out from the mother, the baby look like depressed. It's not good. So, in 2000, my research partner, I, female chimpanzee, gave the birth to her son named Ayumu. I strongly determined only one thing, only one change, different from the Western world. Don't take the baby out from the mother. So putting the baby with the mother, and I join their daily life to carefully observe their cognitive development. So that is called participant observation, started in 2005, Ayumu, 5 years old. 2009, the son, 9 years old. 2012, 2015. By the way, my hair was black. So, not only me, I, Ayumu, but also my colleague Masaki Tomonaga and Chloe and Cleo, Masayuki Tanaka and Pan and Pao. So the researcher, the mother, and the child. Triadic relationship. I can ask the mother chimpanzee to help me to test your kid. The tradition is continuing to the next generation, Misato Hayashi. So essentially, participant observation, it's a cognitive test. In the assistance of the mother, you can do exactly the same thing to compare the two species in the exactly the same situation. Even more, participant observation allows me to do something like injection. All chimpanzees, all humans, we don't like it. But based on the mutual trust and mutual respect, I can ask chimpanzees, behave, I will inject you. And it is accepted, no problem. No reinforcement training, no, nothing. Based on the mutual trust, you can do it. They are hominids. So you can do a longitudinal development of the brain, MRI image, brain image, for the first 6 years, or even more, based on the MRI scanning, we got the blind sight missing part of the brain, but no fundamental damage on the daily life in a chimpanzee, or even more, event-related evoked potentials, so EEG, electric encephalogram from awake chimpanzees. So this is Japanese chimpanzees, okay? Not American chimpanzees. They can behave. Put an electrode. And just, I want to introduce only one important finding. In the participant observation, we can ask the pregnant female lying on the back and use a Doppler sonar image of the fetus. Of course, the image is not precise as the brain image, but still you can measure the diameter of the brain. You can easily calculate how much the volume is. Okay? So here is the result, unexpected result. Let's compare human fetus and chimpanzee fetus, the brain volume. Of course, both cases, the brain volume increases along the gestation period. That's clear. Always monotonically increase. But the y-axis is increment of increase. How much increased at certain point? So linear in humans means exponentially increase. So gestation period, always increase, increase, increase. But it's not the case in chimpanzee. The increment of increase is at the maximum at the point of 22 weeks. Then the pace of increment is slowed down. Why? The uterus, womb, is so small. Sometimes you do not recognize the female chimpanzee is pregnant. The womb is small, so long arms and legs are folded in the small world. But in the human case, it's huge. So the fetus can push or touch the face. A lot of things they can do in the fetus area. Let me proceed to another example, very interesting example, of 1-year-old human infant looking at the touch screen, looking at the monitor. Exactly the same situation, chimpanzee looking at the monitor. And on the monitor, there is a very simple scene of young lady, orange juice, pouring orange juice bottle into the cup. Very simple video clip. The same video clip is shown to human, 1-year-old, or an chimpanzee. And yellow and red dots is the fixation point, the gazing. Where do they look at? Look at the right side, chimpanzee case. Chimpanzee paying attention to orange juice. Only orange juice. But human baby, look at orange juice and look up the face of the lady and look down. And look up and look down. So human see this world in triadic relationship of me, you, and this object. Chimpanzee is lives in dyadic relationship of me and orange juice. So it was desktop eye tracker, but now we are using wearable eye tracker. So we published papers and then assembled into the books, published from Springer and Springer Nature. Field observation in Guinea, Bosu. First of all, I want to introduce Africa because it's not so familiar to you. Africa is a huge continent that includes India, United States, China, Europe, and more. And my research site is Bosu, the country is Guinea-Conakry. There is a field station there. And since 1986, so this trip, after this conference, I go to Africa. this is the 30th anniversary, so 30th annual field trip to Africa. The chimpanzee there is known to use a pair of stones to crack open nuts, oipan nuts, in the field experiments. In the field, it looks natural, but it's an experiment. As you see, the number is attached to the stone. Female chimpanzee pick up a nut, place it on the anvil stone to crack it open. By the way, she is left-hander. So we found perfect laterality of handedness in chimpanzees. And published a book from Springer. So four topics: imitation, language, social bond, and imagination. Imitation. Conclusion: apes do not ape. It's difficult. Possible, but difficult. As I have shown you, it takes 4 or 5 years to acquire this stone tool use skill. So this means 0, 1, 2, 3 years old, they cannot do it. So annual field trip. I wanted to know the developmental change, how they acquire the skill. Traditional, unique culture of the chimpanzee there. Oops. Cannot do it. 3 years and a half, so she cannot do it. In such a case, she goes to the mother or the other chimpanzee and look carefully in such a short distance, close distance. I don't know why, but in a close distance, they want to see what's going on. And the important point, no teaching, no active teaching from the mother and adults. And the child tried to do it by herself. So I named education by master apprenticeship. Three important points. No active teaching, no teaching. But infant has a very strong intrinsic motivation of making the copy. And the third point, as far as the child comes, mother and adult show high tolerance. Do not say, do not chase out. So education by master apprenticeship, no active teaching, intrinsic motivation to make a copy, high tolerance towards the children. In the laboratory too, just looking. So that is the outgroup. So human, what is uniquely human? That is teaching, of course. But not also teaching, but also molding, scaffolding, helping, social praise, all is uniquely human. To conclude this section, I want to show imitation that is possible in chimpanzee. So this is in captive situation. This is the first time I show the model of using a phone. It's a toy phone. It's fake. This is the first time. And the mother chimpanzee, look at my behavior, then had the opportunity and put it on the ear. So it's possible, but not as general like humans. So the second question, what is uniquely human? So second answer is language. Of course, language is uniquely human. IE chimpanzee is a sort of ape language study, the tail end, still going on. So she learned to use Arabic numerals, letters of the alphabet, Chinese, Japanese letters, and so forth. Today, let me focus on the number. IE chimpanzee learned to use Arabic numerals and, double quote, count the number of white dots on the screen. One, seven, five, one, six, seven, three, two, four, five, okay. And that is so-called cardinal aspect of number, to count the number of items. Now, ordinal aspect of number is first, second, third, fourth, the sequence. Oops. Chimpanzee can touch 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. At the age of 4, we started to teach. And 4 years and a half, only 6 months is good enough for the chimpanzee to learn 1 through 9. No problem. One of the easiest tasks. After touch white circle, 9 numerals appeared in the random position, but he can touch from 1 through 9. Clear? So this is clearly shows as chimpanzee knows the ordinal aspect of the integer. So, based on this knowledge of the number sequence, I tested the memory. Exactly the same apparatus and test. After touch white circle, 9 numerals appear, you have to touch 1. But in this masking task, after touch 1, the other numerals gone. Turn to white rectangles. What you have to do is to touch where 2 was, where 3 was, where 4 was. I gave you the detailed explanation, so please try challenge to the chimpanzee. Oops. Oops. Oops, sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah? Touch 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay? You try. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Don't worry, no one can do it. I know, the latency is only 0.5 seconds. No one can do it. And when the paper was coming out in 2007, not all people are happy to see chimpanzee can be better than us. Especially the person in the world, in the West, Christian people, very clear dichotomy of humans and animals, and lots of questions, how about the training effect or experience and so forth. But the claim is wrong. Look at this one. Now, 2 numerals missing, 7 numerals. But no problem. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 4 and 9 are missing. 1, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, 2 and 6 are missing. It doesn't matter because this chimpanzee knows the sequence, the order of the numerals. Then let's go to the memory task. In this case, the 7 numerals flashed very briefly, 0.2 seconds. You cannot see the whole, but you can recognize the numerals that are there. Two, three, something, right? You can do it. One, one, two, three, four, five. I tested my graduate students of Kyoto University, the most prestigious university, and their performance is zero. So no one can do it. So it's not a matter of training. Chimps can do it, we cannot do it. But 10 seconds later, he can do it. So not only the instantaneous extraordinary memory, but that memory continues for at least 10 seconds. So at the moment, we continue to know how much items they can remember, how short duration is good enough, and how long intervals they can remember. So at the moment, people are surprised about the performance of chimpanzees. But once you accept that chimpanzee can be better than us, what Matsuzawa did is I invented a new method to assess the memory. How many items, how short duration, how long interval you can remember using Arabic numerals. So in the parallel effort, I have been teaching the symbol of color. It's actually letter, Japanese-Chinese letter, to the chimpanzee. White goes to the corresponding letter. Green goes to the corresponding letter. Brown, purple, orange goes to this letter, and the reverse, pink, this letter means brown. Red, green, gray. Through this test, I recognize chimpanzee can do it, can label the color by the symbols, vice versa. But it was very difficult. It takes a long time for us to teach this kind of things. Because the letter red, it's not red. It does not remind us any color at all. We have to imagine what this letter means. Color red, it does not remind us of any particular shape. We have to imagine what is the letter corresponding to this color. Yeah? It needs a training. So I postulated the trade-off hypothesis. The common ancestor of humans and chimpanzees may have this kind of extraordinary memory. We have such a memory, but in the course of human evolution, we lost it. In return, we got the capability of language, representing the world by symbols. So the third topic is social bond, that is focusing on stable spine posture that makes us human. The Japanese monkey is walking on the beach. When they stop, their body trunk is upright because climb up to the trees. And their hand and feet. Look at this one. The feet looks like hands. Why? Again, climbing up trees. You have to grasp the branches. So actually, chimpanzees, monkeys, non-human primates are four-hand animals, not four-legged animals, four-hand animals living in the tree. And in the course of human evolution, we invented foot to walk. So if you put a baby chimpanzee on the back, they raise right hand and left leg. 5-6 seconds later, left hand and right leg alternate. In orangutan, same. Chimpanzee, orangutan, they cannot be stable on the back. Why? They are trying to cling the mother. They are always cling the mother 24 hours a day, and the first 3 months, never away from the mother. So, evolutionary basis of mother-infant relationship. Humans are unique because of stable supine posture. Why the posture is important? Face-to-face communication, vocal exchange, manual gesture. So hands are free from the beginning. It's not bipedal upright posture and walking makes hands free. No, right from the beginning, hands are free because of the supine posture. Body is supported by the back. So let me conclude my talk, imagination. Chimpanzee love to draw. This is the drawing by chimpanzee. If you show the chimpanzee photo, love to draw the face. If you show the face, love to draw eyes and mouth. So what they see is what we see. So the perceptual world is not different. The perceptual world is not different, but there is a test of showing the sketch of the face of chimpanzee. But one eye missing, both eyes missing, facial parts are missing. And it's free for the chimpanzee, and they love to draw the facial contour. No chimpanzee put eyes, nose, mouth into the face. Blank space for chimpanzees. But humans, 3 years old, Babar comments, oh, no eyes, eyes missing, and draw eye in the blank space. They can imagine what there should be. So 7 chimpanzees, always facial contour. No chimpanzee draw anything at all in the blank space. But human can put the facial parts into the blank space based on the imagination. So my interpretation, chimpanzee is looking at what is present, we are thinking about what is absent. So, yes, it's amazing, extraordinary capability, but there are new males. So chimps are so good at looking at what is present. We cannot do it, but we can think about something missing. So, conclusion. What is uniquely human? One word, imagination. Mental time travel and mental space travel, the range is different. I don't say chimpanzee cannot imagine, but the range is different. Chimpanzee mainly live in the world of here and now. They seem not to be anxious about their future. Chimpanzees live in the world here and now, so they do not become disparate. They are not anxious about their future. They are not anxious about tomorrow. But humans sometimes become disparate, easily become disparate. However, because of the power of their imagination to think about the future, we can have a hope. Humans, we can have a hope. That's the conclusion from my research of chimpanzees. Thank you very much.